God is love. And those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Would you please be seated? It's an honor to welcome all of you to worship today, because we are here to worship the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and to celebrate His faithfulness to each and every one of us, but especially today, to give thanks and praise to God for His blessing over Brian and Mary Ellen as they come before Him to join together in Christian marriage. If you don't know me, my name is David Taylor. I'm the pastor of discipleship and mission at Christ Community Church in Montreat, but it's a privilege because I'm also a good friend to both Brian and Mary Ellen. And so it's just such an honor to be able to be a part of this day and to have one of the best seats in the house for this. But I can tell you that they have wrestled honestly and faithfully with God. They have sought to honor Him and all that they've done to bring Him to this moment. And so this is a joyous occasion. And so I just cannot tell you how excited I am, not only for what God is doing, but what He will be doing to bring us all to this day. So again, thanks and praise to God. We also want to extend a very warm welcome to those who are joining us online. You know, this pandemic season has not let this day be everything we've wanted it to be, but we know that we're worshiping a God who is Lord of all time and space, and so we are joined together by His Spirit in worship together, whether we're in the room or whether you're joining us from where you are. So we do welcome you as part of this day and for all that God is doing. And indeed, we are gathered this morning in the presence of God, the living God, to give thanks for the gift of marriage, to witness the joining together of Brian and Mary Ellen, to surround them with our prayers, and to ask God's blessing on them so that they may be strengthened for their life together and nurtured for their love of God. You know, God created us male and female and gave us marriage so that husband and wife might help and comfort each other, living faithfully together in plenty and in want, in joy and in sorrow, in sickness and in health all of their days. God gave us marriage for the full expression of love between a man and a woman. In marriage, a woman and a man belong to each other, and with affection and tenderness freely give themselves to each other. God gave us marriage for the well-being and the ordering of society, for the ordering of family life, for the birth and nurture of children. God also gave us marriage as a holy mystery in which a man and a woman are joined together and become one, just as Christ is one with the church. In marriage, husband and wife are called to a new way of life, created, ordered, and blessed by God. And this life must not be entered into carelessly or from selfish motives, but responsibly and prayerfully. But this morning, we rejoice that marriage is given by God, blessed by the Lord Jesus Christ, and sustained by the Holy Spirit. Therefore, let marriage be held in honor by all. Let us pray. Almighty God, You are faithful. You are so very faithful in Your love over us. And we ask that You would look mercifully now upon Brian and Mary Ellen, who have come seeking Your blessing. Let Your Holy Spirit rest on them, so that with steadfast love they may honor the promises they're about to make this day through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. So Brian, understanding that God has created, ordered, and blessed the covenant of marriage, do you affirm your desire and intention to enter this covenant? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Mary Ellen, understanding that God has created, ordered, and blessed the covenant of marriage, do you affirm your desire and intention to enter this covenant? If so, say, I do.
I do.
Families of Brian and Mary Ellen, I would like to invite you to stand. Don't be shy. So I have a question for you. Do you, the families of Brian and Mary Ellen, give your blessing to them and promise to do everything in your power to uphold them in their marriage? If so, say, we do. Now, everyone else, I invite you to also stand. Will all of you, witnessing the vows that Brian and Mary Ellen are about to make this day, will you do everything in your power to uphold them in their marriage? If so, say, we will.
We will.
Now, Brian and Mary Ellen, I want you to just look at all the people who are standing and know that you do not do this alone. They've got your back. They are with you. They're supporting you. They are loving you. Don't forget this stand of friends who are with you. So now, who presents this woman to be married to this man?
I do.
Two are better than one, because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. Give thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives, as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. In the same way, husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. Therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This mystery is profound, and I am saying that it refers to Christ and the church. However, let each one of you love his wife as himself, and let the wife see that she respects her husband.
Well, Brian and Mary Ellen, you've heard me say it before, but I'm going to say it again. It really is a joy just to be able to be here at this moment and what God is doing here. Because you've given me the privilege of walking with you for some time now, not just a couple of months, but a couple of years. And to get here, you have gone through a lot. You've gone through laughters and tears and ups and downs. You've both done a lot of hard, honest work. You've talked to one another well. All of that just to arrive at the beginning. Yep. The joy, the heartache, the struggles, the triumph, just to get to the starting line. And so allow me, Brian and Mary Ellen, to welcome you to the beginning. You know, marriage gets a lot of bad press these days. You've probably heard people give warnings about it's not all it's cracked up to be. Certainly the pandemic has put a lot of strain on marriages. Some have been hurt by it will warn you that, you know what, you just better be ready for this to fall apart. Even some experts argue that to expect your marriage to last is unrealistic. And we've all seen and heard all the statistics about divorce. And it's enough to make you wonder, is this it? Do I really want to dive into that? It's enough to make anybody second guess, is it really worth all the trouble? But you know what? Marriage in God's economy is something very different. Because your marriage is not a statistic. It isn't about just living life together. It's about two becoming one. And that's a mystery. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. Because as Christians, we bring a peculiar understanding to marriage. As beings made in the image of a relational God, it means we're made for relationship. We're made to be connected to one another. Or as God puts it, it's not good for us to be alone. So God builds marriage into creation itself. Before sin or brokenness comes in, it's a good and holy thing. But conversely, if it's not good for us to be alone, then it's not good to be lonely. It's not how God has meant it to be. And you both have known something of loneliness. You've known what it's like to be alone. But you've also seen God be faithful. You've seen God provide for you in the midst of that loneliness. For the ways, Brian, that he's used your accident to draw him closer to a deeper relationship with him. And then to bring an amazing woman into your life. Mary Ellen, how God prompted you to reach out to him on that fateful night and then to suddenly find next to you a godly man. God is providing relationship for the both of you. He's done it before now, he's doing it now, and he will continue to do so. And it's quite clear to me, and my hunch is just about everybody else here, that there's a reason behind this. If he's brought you to this moment, he's not about to abandon you now. Because as he has until now, God will continue to provide for what you both need to make this thing last as long as we both shall live. And not just simply as long as we both can stand each other. And the Ecclesiastes passage that you've picked really puts the Bible's view on display. Two are better than one. They have a good reward for their toil. You know, we have somebody to pick us up when we stumble, to help us to survive the cold night, to have someone who's got our back. And if life is as hard as everyone says it is, and indeed sometimes it is incredibly hard, then it's better to have somebody with you that you can trust to face it together. Marriage, like a strand of rope woven together, brings an enduring promise that you will be there for one another, no matter what. But it's that third strand that the Ecclesiastes passage alludes to that makes the difference. It's the presence of God woven into your lives that makes all the difference. Relationships can be hard, and the warm affection you feel for one another right now will come and go, as all feelings do. That's why today you bind yourself not to the way you feel about each other, but about the promise that you're about to make to one another. A promise that is rooted in the very promises of God toward you and toward all of us. And those are promises that God keeps faithfully on unconditional love. And you see, when you exercise that Jesus-sized promise to one another, your marriage will not easily. Now, it's a bold move, frankly, to bring that Ephesians 5 passage to your wedding day, right? I mean, because everybody's quick to jump on the wives submit to your husband thing. But you know what? Jumping on that passage and thinking only about that breaks one of the very fundamental rules of reading the Bible, which is taking a verse and pulling it out of its context. You got to understand the big picture here. And this chapter in Ephesians begins with the line, "Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God." Now, this is written not to married couples. It's a posture fundamental to all followers of Jesus, married and unmarried, to do just this, to love others, to give themselves up in order to be a sacrifice of praise to God, to love one another as Jesus has loved us. But that's when Paul drills down and brings the broader principle to bear on Christian marriage. And even that teaching doesn't begin on the infamous verse 22, but on a verse or two ahead, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. So just as it's a fundamental posture for all Christians, husband and wives are to maintain a commitment to love each other sacrificially. Wives submitting to their husband is then counterbalanced with husbands loving their wives as Christ has loved the church. And Brian, you know what Jesus was willing to do for the church? To lay down his life, to die out of love for the church, cherishing, caring. That means there's no lording over here, for the Lord of life himself chose not to use his almighty power to dominate, but to use his power to love and serve and lay down your life. And he is the model of your marriage for both of you. I'm really glad that Paul also lays that line down that it's a mystery, because when a wife and a husband commit themselves to the Lord in their marriage, something very special emerges, something very different than the marriage that the world tends to celebrate. Because, you know, the popular view of marriage is that it will fulfill me, that that the coming together will be something that satisfies a longing deep down. But that's the problem, because the moment there seems to be a stop to that, then using a marriage as a tool for my own self-fulfillment becomes all too easy to discard and to go out and buy a new one. But see, Christian marriage turns that on its head. It's the sacrificial submission to one another that makes all the difference. It's the commitment to regularly put the other's needs before your own. And the beautiful irony is, as you do that, as you seek to meet the needs of the other, your own needs will then be met. That's the really mysterious thing about Christian marriage, that it's not about me. And it's not fundamentally about being happy, although nothing wrong with that, certainly. But fundamentally, your marriage needs to put Jesus on display, both to one another, but also to us and to the world. Your marriage is meant to be a witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And let's face it, the world needs Jesus, and it needs it now more than ever. It needs a love like any other. In a world where everything keeps changing and things keep feeling like loss, it needs to see a love that can endure, and it will see it in your marriage. When you choose to live out the vows that you're just about to make in a minute here, you will testify to the promises of God who stick it out with us no matter what, the ups and downs, the successes and failures. Obviously, it's no guarantee that it's going to be easy. On the contrary, marriage is hard because relationship is hard. Self-sacrifice doesn't come naturally to any of us. But you do not do this alone. That's the difference. The Lord is with you. We are with you. And the Lord has given you each other as well. So Brian and Mary Ellen, welcome to the beginning. Amen. If you want to join me up front here. (Laughter) You don't get to start the honeymoon yet, right? All right. Well, Brian and Mary Ellen, since it is your intention to marry, now having joined hands together, I now ask you, with these promises you make, bind yourselves together as husband and wife. So Brian, please repeat after me. I, Brian, take you, Mary Ellen.
I, Brian, take you, Mary Ellen.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
And I promise.
And I promise.
Before God and these witnesses.
Before God and these witnesses.
To be your loving and faithful husband.
To be your loving and faithful husband.
In plenty and in want.
And in plenty and in want.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
All right. I'm Mary Ellen. I ask you to make this promise to Brian. I, Mary Ellen, take you, Brian.
I, Mary Ellen, take you, Brian.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
And I promise.
And I promise.
Before God and these witnesses.
Before God and these witnesses.
To be your loving and faithful wife.
To be your loving and faithful wife.
In plenty and in want.
In plenty and in want.
In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
As long as we both shall live. What do you bring as a sign of this promise?
Ring.
All right. Thank you. Rings have long been used as the symbol for this covenant relationship together. And it's appropriately so, made out of precious materials, unique, unlike anything else. But also a circle, a reminder of the unending promises of God that will help sustain and bring marriage. And so as you get used to the weight of this ring, as you catch it throughout the day, as you find yourself fiddling with it, let it be a reminder of the promise that you've just made, as well as the promises of God for the two of you to be with you no matter what. So Brian, taking this ring and placing it on Mary Ellen's finger, please repeat after me. This ring I give you,
this ring I give you,
as a sign of our constant faith,
and as a sign of our constant faith,
and abiding love. In the name of the Father,
in the name of the Father,
and of the Son,
and of the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit,
and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, Mary Ellen, taking the ring and placing it on Brian's finger, please repeat after me. This ring I give you,
this ring I give you,
as a sign of our constant faith,
as a sign of our constant faith,
and abiding love,
and abiding love.
In the name of the Father,
in the name of the Father,
and of the Son,
and of the Son,
and of the Holy Spirit.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hope through life's fearful path, for my love is often hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Those He loves are His delight. Christ will hold me. Precious in His holy sight, He will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by Him at such a cost, He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast, raise with him to endless life. He will hold me fast till our faith is turned to sight when he comes at last. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast, for my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. He will hold you fast. He will hold you fast, for our Savior loves you so. He will hold you fast.
Let us join together praying for Brian and Mary Ellen as they step into this life together. And at the end of this prayer, we'll have the Lord's Prayer with debts and debtors and invite you to join when that comes. So let's pray. Eternal God, creator and preserver of all life, author of salvation, giver of all grace, look with favor upon the world that you've made and that you've redeemed, and especially upon Brian and Mary Ellen. Give them wisdom and devotion in their common life, that each may be to the other a strength in need, a counselor in perplexity, a comfort in sorrow, and a companion in joy. Grant that their wills may be so knit together in your will, and that their spirits in your spirit, that they may grow in love and peace with you and each other all the days of their life. Give them grace when they hurt each other, to recognize and confess their fault, and to seek each other's forgiveness and yours. Make their life together a sign of Christ's love to the sinful and broken world, that unity may overcome estrangement, forgiveness heal guilt, and joy conquer despair. Give them such fulfillment of their mutual love that they may reach out and concern for others. Give to them, if it is your will, the gift of children and the wisdom to bring them up to know you, to love you, and to serve you. Grant that all who have witnessed these vows today may find their lives strengthened, that all who are married may depart with their own promises renewed. Enrich with your grace all husbands and wives, parents and children, that loving and supporting one another, they may serve those in need and be a sign of your kingdom. Grant that the bond by which all your children are united to one another may be so transformed by your Spirit that your peace and justice may fill the earth through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Not be all else to me.
Please remain standing. Before God and in the presence of this congregation, Brian and Mary Ellen have made their solemn vow to each other. They've confirmed their promises by the joining of hands and by the giving and receiving of rings. Therefore, I proclaim that they are now husband and wife. Blessed be the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen. You may kiss your bride. So, Brian and Mary Ellen, as God's own, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, and patience, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, and crown all these things with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And now to you gathered here, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace now and forevermore. Amen. Now, before you go, a very quick announcement. Brian and Mary Ellen would love for you to come and celebrate with them at On the Nines Bistro at the Mooresville Municipal Golf Course. So please come and join us with that. And it is now my very great honor and privilege to introduce to you, for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Brian Gillespie. Thank you.